So good morning to everybody, happy Rosh Hashanah. And the first thing I have to do is to apologize, because at the time I was asked for the title of this lesson, I was also asked to put some song in it, and I obliged. But in fact, there will be very little song in what I'm talking about. Or at least I decided that it doesn't really make sense to talk about a tea culture in Song Dynasty unless you know something of what happens before and after. Because tea culture and the tea consumers' strategies of consumption during the Song Dynasty are so sophisticated and special that they didn't really survive in later times in China. Whereas in Japan, they gave rise to the Japanese tea ceremony. But as far as China is concerned, the Song Dynasty pattern of consumption was basically forgotten because it was too complicated, too difficult, too expensive, and in a sense too elitarian. So I will start from the very beginning of tea culture in China and go on until more or less Qing Dynasty. So we will go through the Song anyway, without dwelling on that too much. And nothing really interesting happens in tea culture after Qing Dynasty, with the exception of the reinvention of a Chinese tea ceremony, which took place in Taiwan, basically at the end of the 20th century. But it's a totally new, non-traditional phenomenon. So, why this quotation on the screen? Stat rosa pristina nomina, nomina muda tenemus. This is medieval Latin, of course, so stat should be est, but the rose is old as far as the name is concerned, but we only have the names. And this is a quotation from a philosopher and scholar named Bernard of Morlaix, De Contentu Mundi, which also appears at the very end of Umberto Eco's The Name of the Rose. It's actually the last sentence in The Name of the Rose. Now, why that? Because I think we should start from the question, what is tea? Which sounds like a very dumb and obvious question. We all know what tea is, but in fact, it's not so clear. If you look up the word tea in the Oxford English Dictionary, for instance, you come up with at least four different definitions. And one of them has nothing to do with Camellia sinensis. We call tea basically any infusion of any herb, drinkable infusion of any herb. You can even call tea certain kind of beef stock or chicken stock. So it depends really, there's much more to it. And that is the same in China. We do not know exactly what was tea in the beginning. We have a word, we have several old names for tea, but we are not sure whether in fact those words meant tea as we know it or some other kind of herb. What they have in common, all these names, is the fact that they are defined in sources always as bitter. So tea is bitter, tea is good. On the other hand, at some point in later sources, the taste of tea is always defined as sweet. Gum, natural sweet. Not sweetened, but sweet. So at some point in history, the taste of tea went from bitter to sweet. But in the very beginning, tea was bitter. So all these names, this is Shen Nong, you'll see later what's the importance of Shen Nong in the story. This is where tea is supposed to come from. Of course, there is a lot, a long debate since the end of the 19th century whether tea is indigenous in southern China or in northern India. I think it's a total pointless discussion. As far as we are concerned, tea is from this part of the world. And even if we found out tomorrow that tea is in fact from northern India, that wouldn't change the whole cultural system built on tea in any way. So, this is a tea tree. Tea is not a bush. No. We are used to think that tea comes in bushes, so that it's kept in that form for commercial purposes, because you have to reach out and pick leaves. But if you let it grow, tea is in fact a tall tree. The Chajing, the tea canon, in fact starts with the sentence, tea is a huge a tree, comes from a huge tree. So this is just a curiosity. Names of tea, here they are. So as you see, we have different names from tea. One is the name that everybody knows, cha. This one is the character who gave birth to cha by subtraction of an horizontal stroke. And apparently, this change, this modification, took place because people were mistaking one, they were calling two different kinds of plants. One was in fact a bitter herb, some sort of bitter salad or something like that, very bitter, edible, rather than drinkable. And then there was another plant, which is what we call tea nowadays. And apparently, the change took place precisely for this reason, in order to avoid the mistake between one plant and the other. And it took place for the first time in the toponym from Tulin to Chalin. This character is not used anymore. Neither is this one. Neither is this one. This one is actually very rare. This one is still used nowadays sometimes in commercial names, in names of tea houses, in names of certain brands. It also sounds very well because of the min. It sounds the same min as your min. So it has an auspicious sound, of course. But let's say since Han Dynasty on, the character, according to the sources, not that we have any cha in character in Han Dynasty, but the character for tea is cha. And if we read the Cha Jin, in the chapter where he mentions ancient sources for tea history, he corrects all the characters into this one. If you check the original sources, you see that in fact you'll find this or this or this. But in Luyu, you would all just find this one, only find this one. So this is tea. And what was meant by tea at the time, and what are we talking about today? Now we go to the... Today we are talking about green tea. Now, again, what is green tea? First, tea is a plant. It's a plant, and the botanical term is Camellia sinensis L. Ocunza. You wouldn't believe how many people still think that black tea and green tea come from two different plants. In fact, they don't. There's only one plant, and this is the plant. The so-called distinction between black tea and green tea as botanical distinction has to be the blame rests on Linnaeus, in fact, who mistook Thea viridis and Thea roja for two different species. Whereas in fact, it's one, just one plant, Camellia sinensis. So tea is a plant. Tea, so cha is a plant. Cha is also the dried and processed leaves used to make tea. So tea is a plant, tea is a commercial item, a commodity. And then, of course, tea is a kind of beverage. It's what you obtain when you boil or steep or do whatever we will see with the dried leaves of the Camellia sinensis. Why green? Now, the classification of teas is based on processing. So, green tea, black tea, per se doesn't mean anything. It all depends on how the way tea is being processed. And according to processing, you have green tea, oolong tea, and black tea. And this is the spectrum. What's the difference? The difference is in fermentation. Fermentation is a process which starts as soon as you pick the leaf. It's an oxidization, basically. It starts as soon as you pick the leaves, and the key to all the process is stabilizing the fermentation, stopping the fermentation. So in green tea, how you make green tea? Green tea is harvested, is stabilized, and you stabilize tea through heat. It's crumpled sometimes, and it's dropped. Oolong tea is harvested, is withered, that is, they spread the leaves on very large sort of flat baskets. They let it wither for some time, so that the fermentation goes on. Then they stabilize it, they crumble it, and they dry it. And black tea is harvested, is withered, crumpled, fermented, and dried. There's no crumbling, but the difference is that the fermentation process is much longer in the case of black tea. That's why we call black tea fermented tea, green tea non-fermented tea, oolong tea half-fermented tea. Now, we will deal exclusively with green tea. So green tea is, oolong tea becomes important only during chimneys. So basically, all the tea consumption until Qing Dynasty is green tea in different ways, but essentially green tea. That is to say, again, I repeat it, it's non-fermented tea stabilized after harvesting. The characteristics of green tea are, well, this is technical stuff, but it has a certain importance. Minimal oxidization of phenolic components, okay, this is, we can skip this. Naturally green leaves. Green tea is very bright in color. And light color brew. The brew is, it has a light color. And predominance of primary aroma smells. Now, primary aroma smells is an expression usually employed by wine tasters. And that's the interesting thing. The vocabulary for describing tea in China and in the West. In the West, it's essentially based on wine tasting. It's the same terminology and used by sommelier. They use the same terminology in terms of smell, in terms of color, in terms of taste. Whereas in China, a specific terminology was employed for describing the taste, the color, and the fragrance of tea. It's a very interesting terminology with words that usually are not employed, used in that context. There's even a description of a certain thickness of the brew, which is the equivalent of the French word moelleux, which is used to describe certain wines. And there's a word in Chinese even for that. So a whole vocabulary was developed to describe the characteristics of tea. Whereas, as I said, in the West it's mostly they talk about primary aromas, secondary aromas, and primary aromas means the aroma of the plant and not the aroma that comes out of fermentation or processing in general. Now, history of the processing in China. Now we know what tea is. Tea is a certain plant which after tanniness it started to be called cha. Tang Dynasty, Han Dynasty, although we only know it from Tang Dynasty, but started to be called Cha. Now, the earliest references, there's a legendary discovery by Shen Nong, of course, and the, as we know, and the function of tea was, of course, to repel it had to work as an antidote for poisons. So he was boiling herbs and making some sort of decoction in order to dispel some poison. Then, of course, we have other mentions of tu in sources from the 11th to the 17th century BC. But in this case, it's not clear whether tu is what we call tea, or it's a bitter herb, or a bitter herb used as food. For instance, in the contract for a slave, it is mentioned, but they probably refer to eating tea rather than drinking. And then there's the famous Sangorger story of tea served instead of wine. There was this very demanding host who forced all of his guests to drink, I can't remember how many sheng of wine. And there was one of the guests whom he admired greatly who could not bear with that much wine. And so he instructed his servant, the host, instructed his servants to secretly give some tea to the guest instead of wine. And this is the first mention of tea taking the place of wine. In later poetry, for instance, very often you'll come across the sentence, well, in a cold winter night when the guests come, the tea takes the place of wine. So tea taking the place of wine, or even disputes between tea and wine, contrasts between tea and wine personified, are very common. But this is the first mention in literature, as far as I know, where you have tea and wine as two opposed elements. And then we know that before the 7th century AD, tea was already a common drink. The reason behind this are the spreading of Zen Buddhism and, of course, the appearance of the Chaji, so the first tea handbook. Now, in Tang Dynasty, the Chaji appears. Now, the Chajing is a chashu. A chashu is a corpus of books entirely devoted to tea. There's about 108 of them, 5 written during Tang Dynasty, 50 during Ming Dynasty, and the rest is a long history. But the largest number was composed during Ming Dynasty. The chashu are books and monographs on tea. They're usually technical books on tea, and they cover every possible aspect of tea culture, including cultivation, harvesting, processing, brewing, drinking, literary sources, implements, utensils, there's lots of description of utensils, circumstances in which you're supposed to drink or not to drink tea. Some of them are only devoted to one aspect of the question. For instance, there's a good number of them is simply devoted to the choice of water. Which kind of water you should use to make tea. And there are, of course, classification of waters, lists of waters, and some of those waters are real waters. Waters coming from certain places, certain rivers, certain springs. Some of them are idealized, so to speak, waters, such as the waters that drips down the stalactites in caves. I think you get a drop every, I don't know how many hours or days, so it would take you a year in order to make a cup of tea. But there's an idea of purity in that. Even if, from a purely chemical point of view, that kind of water would be terrible to make tea. Of course, the best water is spring water, which they call mountain water in most of the books. Then you have well water and river water. Some other books mention a snow water, the water that you obtain by melting snow, which is not considered a very good water anyway. So and then of course there are anecdotes about waters which show how idealized the whole problem is. Louis was able to tell one water from another even when they are mixed together. There's a very famous story where Louis is having tea with somebody else, a very famous person, and they send a soldier to fetch water from a certain source. But he stumbles and pours out half of the water, so he takes the water from another source, brings the water back to Louis, and Louis says, okay, from here to here is good, from here to here is from another source. So the issue of water, it's very important. I'm talking about briefly the Song Dynasty. One of the books on water was written during Song Dynasty. I've translated three or four of them, and they're quite interesting. For the descriptions of the different kind of waters, and also from some technical informations that you can derive from the sources. For instance, in the Chaching, when they describe boiling water and the different phases it goes through, it's actually the first description ever of heat transferring liquids. There was never before as such a precise description of the process of heat transferring liquids. So even from a proto-scientific point of view, they are very interesting. So the tea canon, the tea book, the Chaching, is the first and perhaps the most complete and the most important of all tea books. Which doesn't mean that we still drink tea the way it was made in those days, and it doesn't even mean that we would like it anyway. Why? We will see. How did they make tea in Tang Dynasty? First, I will show you how they were processing tea. So tea was harvested, and these are illustrations from a Japanese edition of the Chaching, with drawings of the implements and utensils described in the Chaching. So it was harvested and put in baskets, then steamed in a steamer, then pounded in a mortar, so basically reduced to pulp, then put into molds, and those molds could be very pretty. These are very simple, but you had molds in the shape of a flower, molds with the imperial symbols, depending on whom they were made for. Molds can be very attractive. Then it was dried on shelves, and then stringed together, pierced and stringed together. What came out of the molds were cakes. Coarse cakes, not very fine cake, as we would say in the Sung Dynasty. In the Sung Dynasty, the cakes are absolutely compact and fine, and they don't look like tea at all. In Tang Dynasty, they had very coarse cakes, bricks, and they pierced them and string them together, and one string of cakes was almost cash. It was a unit that could be used in bargains. And then it was preserved in a special container which was heated, because the worst enemy of tea is humidity, of course. So they had special heated containers. Then these are the tea cakes or tea bricks, and they resemble nowadays pu'er cha. But as you see, the molds were quite complex and quite attractive. These were molds destined to the emperor, of course. I mean, cakes destined to the emperor, of course. But they could be very complex and very richly decorated. According to the Chajin, how did they make tea? Now, the history of tea making, or tea brewing, in China goes through three phases: a boiled tea, a whipped tea or whisked tea, and steeped tea. Steeped tea is the way we make tea nowadays. So this is the boiled tea according to the Chajin. You take one of those cakes and you roast it over fire. Then you grind it, and if you have in mind the Famenzi treasure, the temple Famenzi, they found some silver tea implements in the Famenzi treasure, and one of them is a roller, precisely like the roller described in the Chajin. So those utensils actually existed, and they were not just a sign of over refinement, but it was ground with the grinder, and then sifted, and then it was boiled. It was boiled in a cauldron, and at some point a measure of salt was added to the liquid. And this is one of the most obscure points in the whole history of tea. Nobody knows why salt was added. The text by Lu Yu is not very clear, nor are the commentaries. Modern scholars think that the addition of salt was simply to balance, maybe, the taste of the water, which came from different sources and maybe had not so pleasant taste, or a taste that had to be balanced somehow. The amount of salt put in the tea is actually minimal. In fact, I'm trying to find the. Louis talks about the right quantity of salt to balance the taste. So it's like when in recipes you have salt without the quantity, and you have to know how much salt, or it's according to your taste. Not only, but according to chemists, it's a big mistake to add salt to tea, because it interacts with other components, so it shouldn't be added. It's been tried. It doesn't improve the taste at all. So it is still a mystery, let's say, why tea was added, and salt was added to tea. Actually, other things could be added to tea, such as orange peel, dogwood, some berries, onions, and the result was a thick soup with some sort of silvery film on top and sediments and dregs. And in fact, all those things, the floating things and the things at the bottom, were supposed to be good. So after the third boil, tea was spooned out to cups and served. And the guests were supposed to drink everything, the dregs, the film, the sediments, and everything that was in it. So basically it was a soup. And even the verb used for this is not, nowadays we say tauchar, it's juchar. Boil tea, and it's not mocha to whip tea, but it's ju like to make soup. So that was a tea in Tang Dynasty. But we have to keep another thing in mind. Tea books are basically books on superfluous things. I mean, Clunas would call them books on superfluous things. They were written by scholars and essentially for scholars. So the kind of consumption described in tea books is an elitarian consumption. We know from the Cha Jing that there were alternatives. There were much simpler ways. This way of making tea, I think, requires altogether almost 30 different utensils. Of course, there were much simpler, a much cheaper ways of making tea, but according to me, this is the way. The rest is water from the gutter. At any rate, so you always have to keep them in mind that there's a, let's say, an upper class, an elitist consumption and a popular consumption. The same as you, the same thing you have in everywhere nowadays with wine, of course. You have a wine culture with sommelier and sophisticated tastes and descriptions and analysis. And of course, then you have people drinking wine from the Tetra Pak from the supermarket. In terms of consumption, they're equally good. I mean, the same thing was in Tang Dynasty and in Song Dynasty, and it is nowadays. You see in China people drinking tea from an old marmalade jar or a jam jar without the cap. And then, of course, you see a very refined way of serving tea. Literature on tea only reflects the connoisseur's consumption. And there are very few hints at alternative ways of consuming tea. The other thing we have to keep in mind is that in Tang Dynasty we talk about jucha, boiled tea, but all the other ways of making tea, loose leaves, powdered tea, whipped tea, they existed already. Only the prevailing, predominant way of making tea was the boiled tea. Second, Song Dynasty. Song Dynasty, 24 tea books were written in Song Dynasty, 15 of which are surviving. One was written by an emperor. Tea in Song Dynasty is a very sophisticated affair. But as I said, we are talking about the connoisseur. Now, tea in Song Dynasty is tea in cakes. But the cakes are totally different from cakes in Tang Dynasty. Instead of being coarse, very coarse, brownish cakes, they are very hard and almost white in color. And you see why. I mean, there's very little tea left at the end of the process in those cakes. And tea is prepared it's whisked with a whisk. Precisely the same whisk used nowadays in Japanese matcha ceremony. You know, I can show you pictures of the whisk. But it's precisely the same kind of tool. Now, how do you make tea well, first you have to know how to present. You harvest it, of course, you know by heart. It's only the buds that you pick, not the whole plant. In Tang Dynasty, you pick the whole thing. Stems, leaves, buds, everything. In Song Dynasty, as I said, it's very elegant, very refined. They only pick the buds. The buds have to be rinsed, then steamed, of course, to stabilize them. Then you have to wring the buds out. That is, you have to squeeze out all the water. And in order to dry them completely, there's absolutely no water left after. Pounded. And then borneo or borneo camphor was added to make it stick together. So in the end, you have something which is extremely refined, with no water content. Very concentrated, very hard because of the addition of other components. Of course, they molded, put in molds, and dried out. Those cakes were very expensive. They were very often granted by the emperor to somebody else's present. And how do you make whisk tea? According to one of the sources, one of the charshu of the time, the charu by Cai Xiang, tea was made this way. You had to roast the cakes, grind them, sift them, and then a measure of that very fine powder. Is the same powder as it is used in matcha ceremony, so it looks like talcum powder. Very, very fine and thin. A measure of that powder was put into a bowl, and then it was whisked with a bamboo whisk. And it made a white foam. Now, the white foam was the best thing of the tea. Not the taste, not the water, not the brew, but the foam. And there were a tea-making competition called Chapel. And during those competitions, the winner was the one who made the longer-lasting foam. Of course, I didn't mention other factors. I talked about water. But we could also talk about fire. There were classification of fire, classification of woods to make the fire, to boil the water, to make tea. But also cups. Because the way you make tea influences the kind of cups that you use. And also, the color of tea is different in different periods. In Tang Dynasty, tea is described with a certain color, which goes from light brown to green. Thereby, the color of cups has to be the best one in order to bring out the color of the tea. Famous sentence, pure as snow, white as jade. The best cups were the celadon cups. But in Song Dynasty, for instance, in order to whisk the tea, tea, the cup has to have a different shape, much larger, less deep, of course, and the black color brings out the foam, the white of the foam. The UN didn't do much. They wrote very few books, and I mean they were not too much concerned with tea culture. Even if I remember correctly, in the year 760, the agency for tea and horses was founded, because brick tea was very much appreciated by the barbarians, the northern populations who were not tea farmers, obviously, but they were horse breeders, and they exchanged tea against tea bricks. So the UN had acquired a certain taste for tea, but very few tea books were written during the UN dynasty. It was mostly whisked tea, but you have one of the first mentions of tea made by steeping loose leaves, as we do nowadays. According to, well, I'll just go through this very quickly, it's the usual, this is the way tea was processed during the dynasty. It's the usual stuff, nothing new. You only have the drying in baskets. But Ming Dynasty has the largest production of tea books, 50 titles. And some of these tea books, I mean, I know I made them sound very dry stuff, but some of them are in fact very poetic. They are not just technical books full of measures and numbers and figures. Some of them are very, very interesting from a literary point of view. Compressed tea, that is to say, tea cakes and tea bricks, were not produced anymore, except for barter. They were kept in production in order to have horses in exchange. And it's Ming Dynasty is when the steeping of whole tea leaves starts. That is to say, not ground, not powdered, not broken, but whole tea leaves, as we do nowadays. It's also when the teapot was born. If there's something that drives me mad, every time I visit a museum, or I see a candle, or I go to an auction, and I see Tang Dynasty teapot, Song Dynasty teapot. Teapots did not exist in Tang Dynasty or in Song Dynasty. They did not exist before Ming Dynasty. That is not to say that the shape doesn't exist. The teapot is a very banal shape, it's a ewer. It's a globular vessel with a spout and a handle. Something that you can use for oil, for soy sauce, for wine. So, the Ming did not invent the teapot when it comes to shape. They invented the function. So for the first time, they used a vessel with that shape to make tea. But Song Dynasty teapot is blasphemy. There's nothing like a Song Dynasty teapot, or even worse, a Tang Dynasty teapot. They wouldn't have known what to do with a teapot during Tang Dynasty, except using it for wine maybe, or for water. I've even seen in a catalog a water dropper described as a teapot. Very recognizable water dropper for calligraphy, described as a small teapot, miniature teapot. Then tea processing, I will just go through it very quickly because we don't have. I just point out to you. Sorry, I go back to it. Pan roasting, so it's not. With the cakes, you roasted the cakes, or you stabilized the leaves through steaming. But when you have entire leaves, you have to pan roast them. You put them in large pans, and very quickly you can move them around until you stabilize them. Twice in the process. This chashu is a very, very famous tea book, a very, very famous Ming Dynasty tea book. And at the end of my conversation, I will read a passage from that book. Again, you have the usual harvesting. I don't want to torture you with this kind of technical details. I find them fascinating, but I know they are not what you're going to taste. And again, pan roasting and drying baskets are the new things. And how did they make? They were steeping loose tea leaves in a teapot, finally, as we do. There is another possibility, which is very common in China, steeping loose tea leaves in a cup. Couple it with a lid. The usual way of making tea. So this is basically the end of the story when it comes to inventing new ways of making tea. Of course, you have Qin Dynasty. In Qin Dynasty, there were about 10 tea books written. I say circa because sometimes it's a question of how you count them. Some of them are just reprints of other books, or with a different title, or just putting two of them together, but let's say about 10 books. And finally, they start, the production of black tea and oolong tea becomes more common in certain areas of China. And it's the beginning of Gongfu Cha in Fujian. That is to say, Gongfu Cha goes with oolong tea. Oolong tea is the half-fermented, which needs a shorter steeping time than green tea. Gongfu Cha, I suppose you know what it is, but it's a way of making tea using very small teapots and cups about the size of a nutshell, or a little larger than a nutshell. It's also called Laoren Cha. It's very common in Taiwan. Well, nowadays, after the reinvention of tea tradition, it's common also in mainland China. But it started in Fujian. Then in Taiwan, during the Japanese occupation, or whatever you want to call that period, of course, under the influence of such a formalized tea culture, like Japanese tea culture, they started thinking about ways of formalizing their own tradition. In the 1970s, 1980s, in Taiwan, some tea houses started proposing to their clients some sort of tea ceremony, claiming it was traditional. It wasn't at all. It was just a Japanized version of something that every farmer did in Taiwan. But from that point on, it became such a successful commercial enterprise that it spread all over mainland China too, and nowadays in Beijing, as in Taipei, as in Chinatown in Vancouver, you would find tea houses doing this kind of traditional Kung Fu tea, but it's not really traditional. So that's basically the end. And of course, everybody in the world drinks tea. And I just want to show you the main. We can do it. So, from the beginning to the end, what happens? When it comes to stabilizing the tea, tea was steamed in Tang Dynasty, it was roasted in Ming Dynasty. In Tang Dynasty there were tea cakes, in Ming Dynasty loose leaves. In Tang Dynasty tea was boiled, in Ming Dynasty steeped. Soon is whisked. Tang Dynasty's powder tea and in Ming Dynasty's whole leaf tea. And that's about the end of the history of tea, but not the end of what I want to say. I will read you a passage from the from this book, voila, which is very interesting, talking about circumstances. According to the first tea book, there are no circumstances under which you drink tea. You can drink tea whenever you want, provided you can come up with the 24 implements plus the I don't know how many utensils, which meant more or less that you had to be rich or you could afford all those things. Let's say from Sung Dynasty on, from the Chalyoji, I think, you can you have descriptions of circumstances and also descriptions of a certain ambiance, of a place where you should or you could a tea house. In Ming Dynasty, when the tea culture is already very well established, you have very detailed descriptions of when to drink tea and with whom, and under which circumstances. And one of these descriptions is very famous, and I will read it to you. It's an impromptu translation, so moments when to drink tea. In idleness and thoughtlessness, when the poetry bothers us, when the thoughts are confused, following the rhythm of songs, when the music stops, in seclusion, far from problems, playing the chin and admiring paintings, chatting in the middle of the night, in a studio in a very bright day, in the alcove or under a veranda, with close friends, with illustrious guests and young ladies. Actually, I think young ladies is not a very good translation. I think it's something like slender concubines. Coming back from visiting a friend in a sunny day, when the sky is overcast and there's a subtle rain. This is my favorite. Admiring multicolored boats from a small bridge. Among luscious trees and slender bamboos, cultivating flowers and taking care of small birds, running away from the heat in a pavilion among the lotus flowers, burning incense in the courtyard, when the wine is over and the guests leave. I love this one. When the children are at school, the explanation for this is it's not when the children are at school. It's when the children are in the fasting hall, that is the place where they used to be tutored by their tutor. The idea is that you should be quiet when the children are around. And there's noise, and you're not supposed to drink tea. So when they send the children away, and then you drink tea. In temples and solitary monasteries, and among the shapely rocks of a famous spring. So this is when you should drink tea. But you should not drink tea when you're working. The idea is that you shouldn't accidentally hit the cup and pour tea over your work. Watching the theater, watching the performance. Writing letters, while writing letters. During heavy rain or heavy snow. I think this has something to do with health reasons, and I think it has definitely something to do with that, because you can do it when the rain is subtle, and the sky is overcast. But if it's heavy rain, yes?
The green tea has a cooling function, so maybe that's why.
Yes, yes, exactly. When I said health reason, I meant
even colder.
You should not. And then, of course, you should not drink tea during big parties and big banquets. This is, in fact, stressing what is said in other in another tea book, when they say that two guests is fine, three guests is acceptable, four guests is so, five guests is a mess. So you should not drink it in big parties and banquets. While browsing, leafing through books, same reason, you don't want to pour tea over books. When we are bothered by events, and also in all the situation opposite to the situation when it's propitious to drink it. That's it. Thank you.
I guess everybody here is drunk too. Questions?
I'm sorry if that's an obvious question, but when does it change that you are allowed or you are supposed to drink tea while watching a theatre performance? Because as far as I understand it, they did drink tea while watching the tea.
Yes, drink tea and eat rats and things like that, yes.
When does it change?
Frankly, it's an obvious question, and my ignorance is very obvious as well, but I wouldn't know. But let's consider also how popular theatre was and how popular a certain way of watching theatre was. So I guess it was when theatre became a kind of entertainment available to larger number of people and in a certain space, because in order to drink tea, I suppose you also need somewhere where to put tea, and so you have to think of what sort of spaces they were watching theater in. And I would say in Qin Dynasty for sure it was allowed, and we know it from illustrations. We know it from probably Yuan, but I'm not sure. I'm really not sure. Also, you have to think, Tang Dynasty's way of making tea was not practical at all, because you needed a cauldron. I mean, you don't go around with your own cauldron, I suppose, especially not in the theater. Song Dynasty was that way, the let's say, connoisseur way of making tea is way too expensive for the common people to be performed. So, nobody would do that under normal circumstances. So it's either the Ming or the Qing, yes, I would say. Yes. Yes.
Difficult to have a secret about stuff.
Well, you mentioned the common people, and you've already also made it very clear that all these books, the tea books, are describing only how the upper classes, then let's say it this way, drink or consume tea. Do we know from when on tea really becomes the national drink?
Yeah, I think in the Yoyang Tatsu, no, in the Memories of the Monastery of Luoyang, you have a sentence that says that in every house, about the Chajing in itself, the Chajing says in every house of China, tea is drunk. And the Chajing is the 7th century. So, and then of course, let's say Tang Dynasty. Because I'm sure the Chajing in itself, and also the memory of the monasteries of Luoyang, says that every monastery has a well-stocked tea chest. So I guess this is one. And also Zen monks were going around carrying their own tea implements. So reasonably 7th, 8th century AD, tea was already what you call a national drink. Yes.
I have a small question, and perhaps even a bit stupid question, because at the beginning of your presentation you said there are three types of tea, the green, oolong, and black tea, and I was wondering, what about white tea?
About white tea, of course, in between the three, if you want to count by colors, there are eight.
Okay.
It's not just... When I said I used black, oolong, and green, simply to define three different kinds of process. Fully fermented, half fermented, and non-fermented. Of course, in between, you have shades. White tea is a non-fermented tea of a very refined kind, but it belongs to the green teas. In fact, green or black is just a question of fermentation, and then you have degrees, of course. Even among the oolongs, you have the oolongs which are among the half fermented. You have the more fermented and the less fermented.
What about the medicinal properties of tea? Do we find any descriptions of tea leaves used as
before they started drinking tea, they were already using tea as food and as medicine. So if you take one chapter, I can't remember the number, in the Chajin that you will see, where you have all the sources, you see that the very first one is the Shenlong Shijin, and there you have mentions of the medical properties of tea. And then, of course, there are several. Even in before the Chajin, you have several mentions of the medical properties of tea. And then, of course, tea is mentioned in the Benzao.
Yeah.
Not necessarily with this name. For instance, the beautiful Benzao, which is preserved in the National Library in Rome, the Benzao Pinghui Jing Yao, which is illustrated as beautiful and in colors, has beautiful images of tea and talks about the property of tea. Let's see if we can insert it. And of course the name is Ming.
Uh-huh.
As that means is bitter. And the reason why the monks were drinking tea was precisely because tea keeps you awake and alert for meditation.
You know, there's this theory that in China they started drinking, or that tea became so popular because obviously if you boil water instead of drinking it out of the well, it's healthy and more hygienic. But you just said that they actually recommended the best water for tea. So maybe, so would you say actually that's not a reason they started drinking tea? Because they discovered it's more hygienic, but if they always just use the best water.
I think taste is evolving. Of course, the fact that when you boil water is then more sanitary than normal water, especially in China, it was an empirical observation, I think, in the beginning. Then it became an acquired taste. I mean, nowadays, in China, people drink hot water, even when they could drink cold water, because hot water is good for you. And then, of course, as the taste evolves, you can tell one water from the other. And we do that with mineral water. We do that with all sorts of drinks. So I don't see a contradiction between that. But if you have to use water, it might as well be the best possible water. What I find interesting about water is that the Chinese invented the science of hot water. So hot water became an interesting subject, the subject of many books, and the object of a science, if you wish, classifying the waters, the sources, even the kind of fuel that you could use to boil the water. You shouldn't use greasy wood. You should not use wood which comes from the demolition of houses. You shouldn't use this kind of wood. You shouldn't use that kind of wood. Then you have a classification of fire, a regimen of fire. So if you look at books of water, like Hoyanshio wrote one, for instance, the Shiryo Tamping, the classification of the 16 boiling water, it's not a classification of waters, it's a classification of water, fuel, and regimens of fire. I personally find this quite fascinating, because through tea, you get to look at you want to call it science or physics, and it's quite interesting.
I just want to pose one thing before your question. It was so widespread, but it was a subject of parody. Yuan Yu Dao, writing just a few years after Confucius, mm-hmm. talks about a man who had special water brought to him from a faraway vacation. Everybody sat down and took it. It was so delicious. And the thing was just in love as well. So, when something enters the culture to such an extent, it's a topic of humor, you know that it's totally white. Absolutely. Because it's something you have to learn to laugh at because you're different.
I was just wondering about the shift from tea cakes to tea leaves, loose tea leaves. Is that because there was easier access to tea? Because tea cakes are easier to store, I think, and easier to transport.
They are easier to store. They are more difficult to make, of course, but
yes.
they are easier to store and easier to transport. But when it comes to preparing tea from loose leaves, is the simplest thing. All you need is leaves.
So you leave out
water.
Some steps, some
yes.
products.
Yes, with tea cakes, it takes a long time to make them, and then a long time to make them, to prepare them for brewing. Just think of pu'er cha. It's not that you just take a cake of pu'er cha and drop it in the water. You have to grind it, at least, if not roast in it. So making pu'er cha is more of a fuss than making tea from loose leaves. So I think it was definitely more practical. Also, after the Sung Dynasty, which was, I think, the highest point of refinement in tea culture, what you have afterwards, the Yuan were not so keen in if you wish, wasting that much time in making tea.
During Yuan times,
yes.
But especially the Mongols.
Is when tea leaves, loose leaves start.
Yes. But they were always with the horses in different places, I think. So later, I think that's why they used the tea cakes, right? Because they could take them everywhere.
That's why they were using bricks, or were you?
Yeah, the bricks, the tea bricks.
The bricks were used for barter, yes. So they.
And they are much easier to take away.
That's true. And even nowadays, you find brick tea more with the nomadic population or with the non-Han population than you find it with the Han.
Can I ask you a question again? I mean, you find Ming records quite clearly stating that they knew that drinking of tea was addictive. Tibetans, which is one of the reasons you could continue the trade. In all the tea books, does it ever mention addiction or this, once you begin to become a heavy tea drinker or regular tea drinker, it's something you find very difficult to give up? Or is it always seen as something positive?
No, it's for the fact that it's difficult to give up it's mentioned in more than one source, but in a positive way, and so do that.
Ah, okay.
You just read the moments to the key in me, and I'm asking, like, is there any regional limitation to the poet moment to drink tea in me? Because maybe it just happened in the pleasure center, like in Jiangnan area.
It is.
So is it any, and where was the author reading?
I didn't get limitations.
Is this kind of circumstance happening in a certain area?
No, this is, I think, first this is a prescription, a suggestion. So it's recommended, but at the same time it's totally idealized. It's a suggestion on, it suggests how you should drink tea. It's not that you should, and all those conditions should be fulfilled, always. And of course it only works in certain areas. I don't know, I mean, this is for instance, says, under ideal conditions, you have to have this and that and that and that. But if you are in the middle of the woods, maybe you can do without this. You still have to keep a certain standard. But Luigi says, if you are on a rock, on a rocky mountain or in the middle of the woods, maybe you can skip with this kind of spoon and that kind of little utensil. So I think, I mean, I understand your question. Of course, those conditions could be realized only in certain centers, in certain parts of China, but it's given as a general prescription, as it is in most of the books on superfluous things. If you look at the books that Craig Clunas calls books on superfluous things, sometimes they recommend collecting objects that do not exist. Mm-hmm. Or they say, oh, you should have that painting for sure. And that painting was lost already 300 years earlier. Or you should absolutely have these fruits and those. They even classify women sometimes, courtesans. But some of those things are totally unattainable. And yet they set a standard. So I think this works pretty much in the same way.
So now we know the unattainable object which we're looking for at every auction that we go to now. A genuine tan teapot. or we were very cruel. We could all after this we could go and say, well, of course, we don't have a tan teapot. Not the point of that. Have we got any further questions? I mean, we did begin a little bit late, but still, lunch is going to be pressing upon us, I suppose, soon. It has arrived. A final question? One final question.
Okay, sorry.
Loudly,
please. I think it's running out of time. Just one detailed question. I'm thinking when you mentioned Louis charging that he said add the salt into tea to make it have a better taste or flavor. So I wonder if it has anything to do with the balance of five elements, because in a tea, it's why it's like a supreme drink, better than all other kind of drinks, because it is a balance, a mix of five elements. It has the water, fire, and also wood.
And iron.
And also salt in ancient China might be a type of mineral.
That's quite an interesting remark. There's also another aspect which I've never ever dared touching, and I'm absolutely not competent, so I couldn't do it. But someone told me that if you read the charging the same way you would read an alchemy book, it would make sense in a different way. So I read it as a technical book on how to make tea with some poetical conceptions, and that's my Zapnik way of looking at it. But in fact, people told me, some experts told me, that certain expressions are just as the same as expression that you find in Nathan books or so. This is quite an interesting. But why only in that book? In no other tea book. That's the other interesting.
Interesting thought that I would like.
Yes.
Thank you so much.